No, it isn't. This is ham radio now. whatever you just said this show was, it's not. It's ham radio now. And here, I can prove it. See?
Yeah, there you go.
And I don't know what you're, I don't know what you're planning on calling it, but we're going to call this the 2019 Tapr Dcc, the movie version.
The movie version.
Yeah, at the movies. And I'll make your job real simple for you. I'll do everybody's title. These are ancient titles.
Here I am. I'm still there. I think it's all still accurate too. I'm not so much co-host though.
Not the co-host. You're the full-time host on Ham Radio Now. The Ham Radio Now version of this program.
But it's
right.
Yep. Yeah. And I am not the producer, editor, host anymore. I'm not even producing, editing, or doing anything with this episode. I'm just hanging out here. But it's an ancient title. And Jason, there's yours.
Okay. It's over your picture right now.
It's over my picture. Yeah. That doesn't help. But all right. Well, here's what happens if I try to make it over your picture. We get this.
Oh, whole, yeah.
Whole of mirrors effect.
Well, you could do that and promote him. Okay.
Right.
You click on.
He could, but it's still over my picture.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, got it. Yeah. This is weird technology we're doing.
It is. Yeah. It is. Okay. Well, I wanted to, Gary, I know you and I have talked about following up for a while because you're out of the ham radio video.
That is true. Much to the consternation of my genre. Legion of fans.
Right. Right.
And I still get hate mail about it too.
You do a show.
And
sometimes I do a show, but yep. I get hate mail.
It's been a while since you've done a show, hadn't it, David?
Yeah, I kind of took the summer off and getting ready to ramp back up. The kids are back in school, and I have.
Let me point out that David's summer began in February, but you are in Los Angeles, so it's hard to tell.
Woo!
Okay. Busted.
Uh huh. Okay. Good. Okay. Well, so tell us about what do you have, David? Do you have specific plans for what's upcoming, or what?
Yeah, I'm working on a couple things. I've been talking to Jim Aspinwall and NO1 PC. Got it right for a change. We've been doing some Elmering stuff and actually got really good feedback on the last show we did with Ward Silver and a little bit more Elmery, a little less Talking Heads. And we'll be doing some of those things. I've got a couple of possibilities lined up. But the biggest challenge for me has been getting people to line up and step up and like show up on the thing. And I'm still having a hard time sitting in front of the camera here just by myself talking to myself. Gary, you're really good at that. I have a challenge because I got to go over the place.
I had to because no one else would talk to me.
Yeah, and that's kind of the problem that I run into.
Yeah, a co-host, a permanent co-host is a good thing to have.
Yep, and I probably
Jason, should. you don't have a co-host.
Nope. No. Well,
you just babble into the camera.
Right, but I've started doing live streams on. In addition to my current pre-recorded and radio review videos, as it were. And Frank, one of these guys that a friend of mine, who's a local guy, lives just down the street from me and a ham radio operator. He's only had his license for a couple of years. So he's a KG5, Kilo Golf 5, which they're on the KI5s now. But
get any call sign he wants.
Right. Yeah. But that was his issued call sign.
Yeah. Which people fall in love with, and they shouldn't.
Yep.
Yeah. I guess.
My advice is when you get your first license, go get a vanity right away before you fall in love with that awkward, god-awful call sign the FCC sends you.
Yeah, I have mixed emotions about that because now I don't mean this in a derogatory manner at all, but it's going to sound like I do. Then you get a bunch of guys who have W5 calls, or maybe in you guys, W0 or W6 calls.
So they all sound like they've been around for 40 years.
Right. Yeah. Years. And then they're asking, they're on the repeaters asking how to program a Baofeng radio. And I'm like, you're a W5 call. Yeah. So yeah. So when I grew up in ham radio, you heard W5, Whiskey Alpha 5, Whiskey Bravo 5 and Whiskey 5 calls. And these were the guys that you would say, hey, can I ask you a question about something? And they would know the answer, but not so much anymore. But anyway, so
should there be a statute? There should be a time limit. You can't get your vanity call for like 5 years, and then that way you've learned enough.
There you go. I'd be in favor of that. I'm not against vanity calls. I'm just like, yeah. It used to be a lot easier to tell how seasoned people were with their, by their call sign, but you can't do that anymore. Anyway, well, Frank has, he's come on my live streams from me, and he has very, he's only been a ham for 2 or 3, 4 years. I've been a ham for 25 years. So it makes a good dynamic, in my opinion, because he asks a lot of questions that my audience might ask. So I think it works out well that way.
Yeah. Get it, bring an idiot onto the show.
That's what you did with me, right?
Exactly. We just figured that out.
I am now.
Oh, wow. That's good. So, okay,
there
good.
There are no stupid questions. Just no. Stupid people asking good questions.
Right. So, David, so
I haven't changed at all, by the way, everybody.
No.
Still a jerk.
That's the part that some folks think are missing from my show.
Oh, you need to be a little bit more headstrong.
Yeah.
So, but you're mostly doing interviews, David. Is that?
Yeah. What I inherited from Gary was mostly interviews. It was mostly, you know, find an interesting topic, something that people wanted to know about, or stuff that people didn't want to know about that we thought was interesting, and bring it on and talk about it. And that mostly works if you can find somebody to come on and interview and talk about.
That's true.
Sometimes it's hard to find those people, or they line up a time, and then they end up having, you know, a cold or lumbago or some other excuse to not actually show up when you've scheduled the time to do it. So yeah. We started doing some Elmering because I thought that was important. We're going to say, Gary.
I'll say being on television is scary. Well, that's some of the reason why we started doing that, the MCOM stuff when I brought you on, is because it gave us a focus to bring people on and talk about something in particular that I thought was real interesting to do, but it was still like pulling teeth to get people to come talk.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And you think they want to come brag about what they're doing, but.
Well, it's interesting because every once in a while I'll get an email from somebody saying, oh, you know, I do this cool thing. I'm like, great, come on the show. And they're like, oh yeah, not me. Well, thanks for the topic idea, but I don't have anybody to talk about it. And if I don't know anything about it, I'm not going to put on a really good show unless I spend, you know, a week or two studying about it and buying some equipment. And yeah, I'm not going there.
That happens at every ham radio club meeting too. Not meeting necessarily, but every ham radio club. Somebody comes up with a great idea that the club should do.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And for our group, it's right now it's Arden. We're like diving in, you know, full bore into that. And so I did a couple shows that was towards the end of the last of the shows that I did, where there were some hilltops and some other interviews. And I think I'm going to bring some more back on. Around Arden, we're building out a whole infrastructure here in Southern California, and it's really exciting and a lot of fun, but getting up to the hilltop or getting the time or getting people to sit down and talk about it that are a good interview can be challenging.
Yeah.
Okay, so you people out there, volunteer, get on the show. David needs you.
Correct. I saw your interview with Arden with Randy and was it Andre?
Orvin Paul? Oh, no. Oh, yeah.
Randy,
oh,
no. You did Randy. One with, this was a couple years ago, I think, maybe a year and a half ago.
Randy and somebody else. I don't think it was Andre.
Okay. Okay. And I remember it was Randy. Because Randy and I have, the last 3 years, well, ever since Hamvention has been in Xenia, I've shared a booth with Bridgecom Systems, and the Arden booth, Randy, Andre, and several other guys are right across the aisle from us. So I've gotten to know them. I've recorded several of their forum talks at Hamvention and put them on my show. And I've done a couple of interviews. There's a couple of developers that live down south of me in Texas that I've done interviews with those guys on my show before. So Arden's a popular subject right now. I think if you could keep going with that, I think that'd be a popular subject that people would be interested in.
Yep. There are some guys here asking about doing mesh in this area, if anybody was doing it. And that name came up and no one knew how to pronounce it, but they, you know, so yeah.
Yeah.
The stuff we're getting into here now isn't so much the development side of it, but the deployment. I think that's for hams, that's more exciting, you know, climbing a tower, getting out in the dirt, figuring out how to power stuff. So yeah, there'll be more on that once we get it up and going, and we're actually starting to raise some funds and add infrastructure, and every time I learn something new about it, I think it's cool. I'm like, oh yeah, come on the show and do that. And again, it's back to like getting somebody coordinated to be able to get on there. And Arden's not really on the internet per se, so it's hard to like pull it up in a show because it's not on the internet, and so you have to connect through, you know, this separate internet of things, be able to bring it in and show it to somebody else. And some of the people I know have a connection in through it that we can pull up, and you know, there'll be some of that soon.
So, I've got that.
So you must be too far from a node to be able to connect to it over the air.
Unfortunately, I live in a canyon. and if I was going to connect to the latest node, the one of the ones that we help fund, I think I'd have to have like a 200-foot tower on my, you know, less than quarter acre of.
So property. You need one on the mountain that's right behind you.
Yeah, exactly. But that mountain goes through like, you know, six of my neighbors' backyards and front yards and two streets, and not going to happen.
I have a node here that runs a tunnel server.
Yep.
And I did that for a while. And I can pull that up as a screenshot I could pull up that node interface page as a video capture in fact, one of my live streams have a specific topic every other Sunday. We've been doing a live stream the last couple of months, and I've done a DMR Q&A a couple of times. And one of the times we did an Arden Q&A. So we got people on there to, here's how I met, here's what it looks like, here's what it happens with it, et cetera. In fact, I think that one was probably the most watched while it was a live one. I think I had about 110 people watching at one point in time that day. So it's a pretty popular subject. But yeah, just get a mesh node there at your house where you can maybe tunnel into someone or have someone tunnel into you. Then you can kind of click through it that way. Yeah, it's going over the internet, so it's cheating, but at least you can demonstrate it and say, this is what it should look like if I had an RF link.
Right. Absolutely. So, absolutely.
Yeah. Cool, man. Gary, I know you're, like I said, I thought you were doing an audio podcast when you first left Ham Radio Now. And I know
it is an audio podcast, but it is also a YouTube TV show. Those things get hard to describe.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
It's the same as Ham Radio Now was. It's released as an audio podcast. I guess I would prefer people listen to it as an audio podcast than watch it as video.
Okay.
But then I keep doing things like I did on Ham Radio Now that have a lot of video components to them that don't translate very well to the audio audience.
Okay.
But it's a local show. This is the logo for it. Triangle Talk Show. Triangle is the part of North Carolina that I live in. Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill is the components of the triangle. Mm-hmm. It's whatever I feel like doing. I've got 67 episodes in the can now.
Oh, that's good.
Okay. So I've been, you know, averaging about one a week, kind of like I did Ham Radio Now.
Okay.
It is political. I'm a lefty, and you know that doesn't translate to ham radio very well, because you know most hams are on the conservative side. You know, just you know slightly to the right of Genghis Khan. And so I'm having a good time doing that. And again, it's not all political. It's also difficult to get people to come be on the show, but that's getting a little bit better because there's no audience. And I was disappointed in Ham Radio Now with audiences in the 900, 1,500, 2,000 views. Right now I'm sitting at about 45 for a typical show.
Yeah.
Another 50 or so audio. So.
Well, it takes time to get built up, obviously. Yeah.
Now I look at those numbers. Ham Radio Now started with a built-in audience from the DVDs and the other stuff that I was doing and the appearances on Ham Nation. It started pretty good right away and built up pretty well.
Yeah. I get spoiled because I actually started a YouTube channel about a year ago about Texas-based craft beer breweries, which you and I have hung out at Dayton a couple of times, Gary. You know that's usually what I'm looking for when I'm around the place. So I put up, I don't know, 20 or 30 episodes, and I haven't, and it's still out there, and I haven't put one up in a while, but yeah, they get like 30, 40 views each and kind of die off. And I was spoiled because Ham Radio 2.0, I put up a video and I forgot about it for like 6 or 8 months, and I go back and it has 5,000 views, and I'm like, maybe this is a good idea. So I really kind of, my audience has been really very organic. And over the last year or so, I've done a lot to grow it, and it's increased dramatically in that time. But, for the first year, year and a half, I didn't do anything spectacular, and it just kind of kept going in a steady pace, but I don't know. So
it's interesting because there's a lot of hams and not a lot of hams, you know, 700,000 in the U.S. So they're looking for content, and you know, as Gary said, you know, you pick up and you get a couple thousand views here and there. And every once in a while, there's a show that Gary and I did that would hit, you know, 5,000 more I think the biggest one that I did on my own was the Yuma show where Dick Norton talked. Mm-hmm. And that was like, you know, in a week, it hit 5,000 views and still growing. Because it was political. It was like right on, you know, the league has problems and we need to fix them.
And I was going to ask what's become of that because I'm not hearing much chatter.
I think, you know, once they changed the board out and, you know, got it a little bit more.
Did the new board all just drink the Kool-Aid and gone back to the way things were, or they made real changes?
I think they made real changes. I haven't seen Dick for a while. I'm watching Rhea stuff. I think that they're actually kind of backed away from all of the, you can't talk about this, you can't talk about that. And they're not as draconian. I don't know if they're really doing anything, I mean, which I guess could be a concern, but I think they backed off a lot of that.
Are they coming on shows and talking about stuff?
Yeah. Sadly, I haven't asked enough. Do we lose Jason?
No, I'm here. I'm just jacking around with some settings.
He had to blow his nose.
I think I haven't asked enough, but I think they're still doing stuff. So probably get back to doing that.
And we'll see. If I disappear, this is my radar, and I'm the little blue dot right there.
Right.
And here are typical thunderstorms blowing up. Ouch. They come out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And so there's one just a little bit northwest of me. It's probably going to go overhead. I'm hearing the thunder and stuff.
So, okay.
If I disappear, yep, in a puff of smoke.
And if I disappear, it's because I'm going to melt. It's probably 85 degrees in here. Let's see what the temperature
is. Yeah.
Oh, no, only 82.
He doesn't have air conditioning in the garage.
Not in the garage.
Someday. Oh, wow. Well, it's 105 degrees in Texas right now, so you're not going to hear me playing a fiddle for you. So. But, okay, so in traditional fashion – and I had a link to this, but I don't remember what I set it up as. In traditional fashion, let me switch here.
Yeah, we need to talk about what you're doing.
The Tapr Dcc is coming up, yeah, which is why I asked. I reached out to Gary because Gary recorded the Tapr Dcc five, six, 7 years in a row, something like that.
Starting in 2008, so almost, I think, 10 years.
10 years in a row? Okay. Yeah. And I took the reins last year, and it was in Albuquerque, and I very much enjoyed it. Had a blast. Met a lot of good people. That genre inside of amateur radio is very much right down my alley.
Weren't you amazed when you saw that first one?
Oh yeah, yeah, it was great. And in fact, I got invites from two other places to come and record there. events, and I haven't done anything. Well, the first one I couldn't do because I had a conflict last year, and the second one is upcoming, so we're still trying to work that out. But it was a good experience. Met a lot of good people, and I really much enjoyed it. So
everybody wants you to come, make video of their show. What they don't want to do is pay for it.
Right? Yeah.
So that's what we're here to talk about.
Right? Yeah.
Are they offering to sponsor you at all, or
no? No.
I'll honestly have to tell you, I was so excited when Gary said, "Hey, you know, Jason wants to do this. Is it cool with you?" I'm like, "Absolutely," because there's no way I'm going to be able to do it. Take off work and travel to here and do all the fun. Yeah, there just wasn't any way.
Yeah,
so you're running your Kickstarter now.
Yes, I started a Kickstarter and I did it for 60 days, which is how I did it last year also. And it took about 30 or 40 days, something like that. And then it finally started to, I got a little bit here and there. The first 30 days were kind of nil. So I got a, I set up a Kickstarter for 60 days again, and it's got 14 days left at the time of this recording. And it's only about halfway funded. In fact, it's just
How much are you asking for?
$2,200. Same.
So you are giving them a bargain. My Kickstarters for doing the DCC were, the first one was like 8,000 or 10,000.
Yeah.
And then I could whittle it down a little bit, but the cheapest one I ever did was like 5,000.
Yeah, I was thinking you did 4,000 to 5,000 for your last couple or something like that.
Yeah, and one of them failed, but all the rest of them succeeded.
Oh, okay, okay.
And Gary, you were trying to in addition to covering your travel and lodging and whatever, you were trying to recoup some of your like actual costs of doing the work.
Yeah, because I had a job. I had a freelance job, and doing the DCC editing meant turning down freelance work.
Right.
So
Then Jason, it sounds like you're more trying to recover your costs from actually.
Basically, know, yeah. I mean, last year I put the link to the Kickstarter in the chat, Gary. Maybe you can pull up the page easier than I can because you're running through Wirecast. So yeah, last year I drove to Albuquerque, which was a 10-hour drive one direction. So I took off an extra day. I took off Wednesday. I drove out there Wednesday. We set up Thursday, recorded Friday, Saturday, and half a day on Sunday. And then I drove back Sunday. I got home late Sunday night, like midnight Sunday night, something like that. And yeah, there it is right there. And then this year it's in Detroit, and it's too far to. It's like an 18, 19-hour drive to Detroit from where I'm at. So I decided to fly this year. So I've already bought my plane ticket, booked my hotel room. I won't pay for that till I get there, but they have some deal with Marriott where they're always in a Marriott, I think, because they were in a Marriott this year and last year. But yeah, basically just recoup costs of travel expenses, hotel expenses, and meals while you're there. And then the editing time, because it took me a lot longer to edit those last year than I anticipated. But
yeah, I discovered that.
Yeah. Just like you've said before, Gary, but,
it works out to being about 20 shows.
Yeah.
And I was spending, a full day, maybe a day and a half per show.
Something like that. Yeah. I'm going to take,
people say, it's an hour, a 45 minute talk. Why does it take you a full day? Because there's a lot of work to putting it together. You get shot multi-camera. Mm-hmm. So you got to go through the whole show at least twice.
At least twice.
All the camera shots in there. Mm-hmm. Tweak the audio, get titles. Yeah. Load everything into the computer, get the shots lined up. Mm-hmm. It is more work than you think.
Take me
back when I was doing 30-second commercials, people say, why does it take longer than 30 seconds to put together a 30-second commercial? It took us 3 weeks.
True. Yep. But, yeah, I think I finally finished. I think there was 16 or 17 episodes from last year, and I did not put up the little, what they call them, the lightning talks. I recorded those, but I didn't put those up. I'll probably do that this year. But I've made a goal for myself this year. Once we get everything recorded for the DCC in that's September 20th or whatever that Saturday is, 21st maybe. I've made myself a goal to have all of them edited and posted by the end of 2019.
Yeah, that's what I always tried to do, and I usually kind of trailed off into January, maybe even a little bit of February.
Yeah, I think it was about April before I finally got the last couple episodes posted this year from last year. So,
and I'll bet you learned a lot about how to do those things.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
If you go back and look at the first ones that I did, boy, are they rough.
Yeah,
cameras bouncing all over the place.
Yeah,
I shot with like 1.5 cameras, and it just took forever to sort of make it look like I had multiple cameras. And then eventually I did, and smoothed out the techniques, and then
expanded the time it took you to put it all together.
Well, yeah, that too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I guess the bottom line for me is the incredible value that you're bringing to the amateur radio community by sharing that content, right? Because how many people go to the convention?
About 100-ish, you know, 90, 100, 110, something like that. So, I mean, that's how many were there. That last year is my first year to ever attend. Mm-hmm. And Detroit this year is supposed to be, I think their headliner last year was the Hamsai guys. And then their headliner this year is the Satnogs guys. As far as I know, I don't think that's changed. I think that's still accurate. So the Satnogs guys are given the, I say headliner, that's their Saturday night talk. So I'm looking forward to that. I talked to the Satnog guy a little bit in at Dayton this year. So and he said he acted very excited about it. So but it's I don't know.
They've been to Tapr a couple times.
Okay.
So there's some Satnogs within the Ham Radio Now versions of the show.
Okay. They were not there last year. I tell you what, the coolest thing last year was, in my opinion, was all the Raspberry Pi talks. there was the very first talk was done by Scotty. He's one of the guys who spearheads the DCC, and he's talking about he had researched like 30 or 40 different single board computers and given us a breakdown of what like were his top 10 single board computers, like their Arduino and the Raspberry Pi and all these other ones. And I'm like, man, that was cool. I mean, it took him a lot of time to research all that and put it together and everything. And I'm like, man, that's pretty slick, because somebody who's interested in that sort of thing, that it would save them a lot of time to just watch the research he's done. So, but that was, single board computers are kind of interesting to me. So that was the most I got out of it, but there was a lot of other stuff also.
It's a wide variety.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And most of it, you've got to be pretty technical, and in many cases more technical than I am. But not everything. And I learned a lot every time I did it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. For sure.
The number one thing I remember seeing get developed at the DCCs and then turn into a major thing in ham radio is those first couple of years, 2008, I was seeing the software-defined radio stuff that was all a homebrew or they made some kits and parts and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And today, that is basically Flex Radio.
Yeah. Yep.
And a lot of different flavors too, because you know you have boxes too, and all over the place.
There's so many SDRs out there now. If you go search eBay someday and say SDR space HF.
Yeah, because you can start at like $10 or $20, and then you can go up into the thousands.
Oh yeah, easily. Yes. So yeah, and there's a lot of that out there. And I think Tapr's actually working on a version of their own SDR transceiver. They've got a couple of boards on their website right now.
Maybe left over from those early, you know, products that they had put out. I don't know if they're trying to stay current and you know, push that development now or not.
I talked to Steve at Dayton this year, and they're working on something new.
Okay.
I can't remember exactly what he told me what it was. And again, it was even a little bit over my head, you know, because I don't understand all those ins and outs. I'm not a programmer. I'm not a developer. I don't do any of that stuff. So, but I'm an IT guy, but I was more in the support role when I worked in IT. But
so stay tuned to the DCC videos when they come out, and you will find out, and you'll be first.
That's correct.
Other than the folks that actually show up there in person.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. That's right. So anyway, that is that. So yeah, I would appreciate anybody who could pitch in and try to help me. Yeah, that's that number showing right there is 1,064. My goal is 2,200. And I think my goal last year was actually 2,100, but it almost hit 2,400. It's like 2,375 or something. So I'm just like, well, okay. It's going to cost me a little bit more money to fly this year than it did to drive, if you're just considering fuel, not wear and tear on the vehicle, but if you're just considering fuel to drive to Albuquerque and back, it's cost me a little bit more money to buy a plane ticket. But anyway, so
I could never package all my gear to fly. I always had to drive. I even drove to Seattle, but I did those on the road videos.
Yeah.
Do those on the road videos. It took 5 days, but you know, I made a lot of stuff out of it.
Right. Right. Yeah. I guess if I could quit my job and do full-time YouTube, then yeah, maybe I'll do that one day, but we'll see. When I first talked to Steve Bible about it, he was like, we love having this done because not everyone can attend the DCC every year. And I've talked to a couple other guys that run similar conferences, and their concern was, well, if we advertise it's going to be recorded, nobody will show up.
Yeah.
And according to what Steve Bible tells me, I'm like, he's like, man, the opposite of that has.
Yeah. Probably Gary's recording has probably driven people to go to future years.
I believe. Yeah. That's what he's told me. That's what Steve has told me. So I'm thinking that it's a good thing.
There's probably a mix of both. There's probably some people that don't go because they can watch your recording, you know, 6 months later, and there's probably more people that go in future years because, wow, that's great content. I wish I could be there in the room so I could ask that question that I have, or make the comment, or buy the board, or bring the thing home, or
who
knows?
Right, right, totally. So, Gary, I think you're back.
It looks like Gary's back, but he's got to turn on his camera. So we'll definitely help support you by sharing this up and
excellent
talking about it.
Thank you very much. Yeah. I reached out to Gary a little bit ago and said, hey, I wonder if you could help me because it's kind of lagging behind, but because I know he was always big into the promoting that when he was on the air or on YouTube, I should say.
Yep. I think I'm back.
Gary's back.
There you go. You're back.
Let's see. This is my left hand. I don't know if I'm backwards or not. Am I backwards? I think I'm backwards.
Not to me.
Put your left hand up again. Nope, you're right. You're correct.
Okay. No, you're to us, you may show backwards to yourself, but you don't show backwards to us.
Right. Okay.
So, yeah. So.
Because I've been accused of being backwards.
Well, you said you were lefty up front, so I, that was a dig, but.
Yes.
But anyway, yeah. So I do appreciate you guys coming on the show, and helping to, you know, get the word out. Cause I know that, like I said, Gary really kind of laid the foundation for this whole recording of the Tapr Dcc. And when I heard that, going back to what you said a minute ago, David, when I heard he was quitting, I was like, okay. And I went to, and I didn't contact DCC. I contacted Gary and I'm like, so what are your plans for this? And he's like, well, I was planning on doing it, but do you want it? And I'm like, well, yeah.
I was real happy to hear that
you were
interested in doing it right away.
Cause I didn't want to step on any toes or anything, but I got a real kick out of doing it last year. I really loved it. So.
Yeah. And I think Gary called me and he's like, hey, no, Jason wants to do it. Is it cool? Cause I'm not going to do it. I'm like, oh yeah, absolutely.
It provided a lot of content for the Ham Radio Now channel.
Yeah.
Very classy content. It was a lot of work to make that content, but it made of the 50 to 60 shows that we would do in a year, it made 20 of them.
Yeah.
That's probably one of my challenges. It's probably the one thing I did, that I did lose by not taking the time off to do it all. But again, I don't think I'd have done half the job.
It's hardware intensive and you didn't have all that stuff.
Yep. Right. That's true also. Yeah. You were talking about driving up to Seattle, Gary, because taking all your stuff. I think I'm going to have George, the guy that runs the AV stuff there, he told me that if I needed to ship anything to him, I could ship it to him and he would receive it for me. So I think I might end up shipping some stuff because I think shipping it is going to be a heck of a lot cheaper than paying $25 to $50 for checked bags on the freaking airline.
Yeah.
So, but we'll see. So...
Yeah, I was thinking about going to the Detroit one because it's where I was born.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, but I just can't clear the time this year to do that. But next year, it's going to be in Charlotte.
Correct.
Which is just down the road from me. Mm-hmm. I will see you there.
Awesome. Yeah.
I'll give you a backup cameraman.
Absolutely.
I used to do that with three camera people, you know, and trying to direct people and shoot one camera. That was a nightmare.
Yeah. Yeah,
I winnowed it down to a one-person operation.
Well, you know what? I mean, I ran three cameras last year, and I manned one camera myself, and then the second camera I just pointed the screen and hit record, and then the back camera I did behind the speaker, like you and I had talked about. And realistically, I only used that footage from behind the speaker during the Q&A session. So really it's kind of a back and forth between the two cameras. And then at the end of the session, there's a Q&A and I'd switch back and forth. And sometimes you could see people raising their hands and that kind of thing. So
yeah, I'll give you a pro television tip. It's kind of fun for the audience to see the perspective of what's going on behind once in a while, just switch it up because having a single shot on the guy talking gets kind of boring after a while.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they're going back and forth to slides. Most of them have extensive slideshows.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
But it's still kind of fun to get the perspective of the room to see that there's 75 people sitting out there absorbing this stuff. It's not just you and your YouTube channel.
True. Very true. Yep. It's good.
That's probably part of what drives people to see the video or to see the shows and want to go to the show.
Yeah, that was one of the big things that the Tapr guys and I talked about is like, if we put these videos out, yeah, they're going to be delayed a few weeks or a few months, but is it going to keep people from coming to the DCC itself? And that it's never done that. It's brought people in, not droves. You know, they didn't add 50 more people, but they didn't lose any and they've added 5 or 10 in most years that said, I'm coming live because I just had to after seeing the videos.
Well, see, and that's right before you joined back, Gary. That's what Dave and I were talking about. Cause I've had another, I was telling you earlier, I had a couple other events contact me and want me to do recordings. And one of them was, and I'm not going to say who it is, but one of them was like, they were scared that if they put it out there, that the event would be recorded, that they wouldn't have anyone show up to it, or it would severely affect their numbers. And I said, the only thing I can tell you is that the exact opposite effect has happened to the DCC, and it's been recorded for, actually, I told him for 5 or 6 years before I got it, but apparently it's longer than that. So
2008's first year.
Yeah. So
when you started, Gary, did you approach them or did they approach you? Cause you know, there wasn't anything in the can for them to say, oh, it'd be a great idea to have Gary back.
They approached me. It was a Mark, WB9QZB, I think is Mark's call sign. I had done some forums at Dayton before that and put them out on DVD. And that's the way that the Tapr stuff I did started. The first few years were only DVD. They're online now, but they started as DVD. It wasn't until 2012 that I put them online right away. And so it was, well, we don't know what we're doing. We'd never done this before. I'd done some forums at Dayton before. And he said that, you know, that's the kind of thing, but the volume, the quantity was just immense. The first one was in Chicago. First 2 years I did in Chicago. And it was, just feeling my way through figuring out how to do this. We talked about, well, do I pay you? Do you pay me? I gave him a figure. I said, I think for like $5,000, I would do it and just give it to you. And they didn't have the $5,000. So they said, well, how about you do it and you monetize it however you can, and we don't charge you for it. And that's the way it's pretty much been since then. And that's worked out pretty well. $5,000 would have been a bargain for them, for me at the time. But, everybody's happy. It didn't make me rich. Certainly didn't remember. I'd say if I got an average $6,000 from the Kickstarter, I kind of broke even.
Mm. Yeah.
I was working for minimum wage.
Yeah.
For the time I put in.
True.
But that's very ham radio-ish. You know?
Yeah.
No one expects to make a whole lot of money out of ham radio. Yeah, a few people do, but no one expects to.
And there's somebody in the audience watching this now saying, you're not allowed to make money from amateur radio.
They're wrong.
That's right.
Yeah. I tell them, when people start railing about that on Facebook, I said, yeah, you're right. I think I agree with you. I'm going to call Ellicraft tomorrow and tell them I want a free K4 because it's a ham radio and it should be free. I'm on board with that idea.
Yep.
Come on. So anyway, all right, guys. Hey, I wanted to keep it short. And oh, Gary, you had some toys.
Yeah, okay. I was going to show you a couple of people, because people are going to be wondering, did I leave ham radio entirely? And I have not. I'm spending more time doing the public service events that I had kind of bailed out of in the past, because I'm too busy with the ham radio now stuff. So I'm back to doing stuff like that. I'm getting back into scanning. I've got things from two ends of the economic spectrum. This is a new Bearcat scanner. I've finally gone to the Bearcat side. I was on the GRE Radio Shack side for a long time. Mm. I've finally gone to the Bearcat side. And this is their relatively new. It's the model 100. I can't remember the model name. Does it say on here? It doesn't say what the model is. Oh, yeah, SDS 100. Okay. They got a mobile version and they got the handheld version. It is $650. And you can get options to be able to receive DMR. It'll do P25 and analog out of the box. You can pay for an option to do DMR, NXDN, and ProVoice. I don't know anything about ProVoice. Just different versions, I guess. So I put the DMR option in because there's some DMR professional, you know, business stuff around here and a lot of ham radio stuff. So I put that in. So that boosted it up to the mid 700s or so. And I've never paid that much for a handy talkie.
No,
it was a bite, but does a lot. It's pretty cool. It took me a full week of playing for several hours a day to even get mildly conversant to what it does. And I don't know everything inside this thing to begin with. But I'm slowly getting there. An interesting thing is when you turn it on, it doesn't come on right away. It takes a while to boot itself up and to load the database. an interesting thing that happened, and it's not new. You know, Bearcat started this with their home patrol probably 5 or 6 years ago. You used to buy a scanner and it came empty and you filled it up. In the very old days when I first got started, you filled it up with crystals.
Right.
Then the programmable one started and you just banged on the keyboard for a while until you put in the channels you want. Then databases, radio references, the big database. And then Home Patrol came along and said, well, that makes things too hard for people. So what this does, and with most of the Bearcat scanners and the GRE and Whistler, I guess is what they call themselves now, they're doing the same thing. You get the whole database inside the radio. This radio has got the database for every radio system in the country. Wow. Updated once a week if you want. And then what you do is you start telling what you don't want to hear as opposed to filling in the stuff that you do. So I'm having a good time with it. Still got a lot to learn about how it works. I'm using the software they give you with it. There's better aftermarket software. I'll sooner or later get into that. On the other side of the economic spectrum is this radio that I came across from a company called ArcShell, and there's a couple other brand names. It's kind of like Bofeng and a few of the others that have the same radio. They just brand it differently. This is a 16-channel UHF 3-watt transceiver. It comes programmed on all illegal channels across the business band. It is, if you buy it in quantities of maybe 4 or 5, it works up to about $12.
Wow.
3-watt, 16-channel, no display or anything, just, channel knob, 16 channels, but about $12. I've used this with a group that I volunteer with that communications is important for what they do, but none of them are hams. So I reprogrammed it for channels that are more appropriate for what it uses and got business license, and so it's legal, and it's Part 90 certified. You could put it on FRS or GMRS. It's not Part 95 certified, so it actually isn't legal for those. It would be sort of almost legal for GMRS because it's the right power, and you can take the antenna off. You can't do any of that with FRS radios. Mm-hmm. But program it for itinerant channels or things that make it legal. And get a license and $12. The thing it comes with, and there's 3 models out there. There's the AR5, AR6, and AR7. The AR7 is the newest one. The bunch I got at first were AR5s. It comes with a little headset. It goes around behind your ear, plugs in. This is compatible with Kenwood's. With TYT, with Bofeng's. The only thing it's not compatible with is ICOM. ICOM does things differently. Mm-hmm. And you can buy these by themselves for a couple of bucks a piece. I think you can get 5 of them for $15. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. $1 a piece on Amazon. And they work pretty well. The microphone and push to talk is in this little bud thing. Here, you can see it better. There's no holes in it, so it's a little bit muddy, but it's waterproof. So your transmit audio is a little bit on the muddy side, but the receive audio is pretty good. And I've used it on public service events, and we use them in this group that uses these radios, and we can understand each other pretty well. It's difficult to get non-professional people just using radios to talk clearly and slowly and all that stuff is even hard with hams to slow down. First of all, when you push the button, not this whole group of 15 people, they're not all just waiting for you to talk. They're doing stuff. So you just blurt something out and you expect everyone has now suddenly focused intently on what you've got to say, that you're saying too fast to an earpiece that is not the greatest. So it takes a while to get people to do that. I'm working on the training, but having a good time with it. So it is branded ArcShell, ArcShell. Look for the one that is branded AR7. It's a better headset. The AR5 version comes with a mic that sounds better, but an earphone that is terrible. I'll go with the mic that is not quite so good and the earphone that is clear. And, right. And as a combination, it works pretty well. So that is my, my recommendation. This is your bailiwick, Jason. So
yeah.
Treading on your toes.
Yeah. It was almost an unboxing show.
Almost.
Yeah. Listen to what it does when you turn it on.
Turn on the radio. One.
Nice.
Two. Three. Two. One.
I turned it off. It does not say you turned off the radio.
No, it wouldn't.
Doesn't do that. And, there's a light on it.
Turn on the radio. One.
I think. Here we go. It's a flashlight.
Oh yeah, that a lot of them have that nowadays.
The Bofungs do.
Yeah.
Icom, Kenwood, Yaesu. Mm-hmm. They don't know from flashlight.
No, they don't do flashlights there. But I've got a couple other brands of Chinese radios that have flashlights on now too. So. Well, cool. Hey, guys, once again, I really appreciate y'all both being willing to take some time out of the day in the middle of the day like this and help me out here. David, I might get with you. A couple of us YouTubers got together a couple of weeks ago, and we did a collaboration video. There were about six of us on there, and I did it over Zoom. I recorded it. I'm going to put it out there. It's probably going to post next week sometime. And I kind of thought it was my idea to do it. These are guys I hung out with at Dayton this year, or most of them were. And it was my idea to do it. And I thought, well, I'll get them to do it, see if they're willing. And everybody got on the call, and everybody was like, oh, so when are we doing this again? Kind of surprised me. I kind of thought they'd be like, yeah, this is fun, I guess, but not really interested in doing it. So we're talking about doing it on kind of almost like an every other month thing, something like that. But it'd be...
Absolutely invite me. I know Gary and I did this. We did it once with four or five guys, and then we had Marty's on a kind of a rotation. So yeah, it sounds like a great concept.
Yeah,
get me on the air a little bit more.
Yeah.
David, for sure. David says as soon as it cools down in Los Angeles and his garage is in 85 degrees.
Yeah, I got to steal the fan out of my son's room. I got to log off, guys. But thank you so much for inviting
me. And, yeah. And,
thanks, Jason, so much for covering the Tapr stuff. It's definitely worthwhile and something I couldn't handle.
Absolutely, yeah. Thanks for the support.
And so help Jason out on the Kickstarter and quit yelling at David that I'm not on ham radio now because he's doing great shows. And I will come back one day just to have fun with you guys once in a while.
Super.
Right. Good.
Does everybody remember how we end shows?
Yeah, I've got it focused on you right now, Gary. Go for it.
Over.
And...
out.
Perfect. Thank you, guys.
Thanks a lot. Thanks to both of you.
I got a bail. See ya.
Yeah, me too. Thanks.
All right, bye-bye.